evening to one and all present here. I am Dr. Shaheen Khanum, Assistant Professor, Banati Das Chandiwala Institute of Physiotherapy. And on behalf of VCIV family, I would like to welcome our guest for today, Dr. Sandeep Huda. Dr. Huda is working as an orthopedic physiotherapist at Apollo Hospital since the past 8 years. He holds a master's degree in physiotherapy and is specialized in orthopedics. He has organized several national and international conferences, recipient of several awards at clinical level like Star Performer of the Month and Young Achievers Award. He has also worked with national Kabaddi team in Kabaddi World Cup in 2011 and 12. Sir is here today to share his profound knowledge on the topic knee preservation strategy, high tibial osteotomy and its physiotherapy management. We welcome you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you, Shaheen. Thank you, Shaheen, for giving my introduction. First of all, I would like to thank Dr. Nidhi Kalra ma'am, Dr. Priyanka and Dr. Shaheen for giving me an opportunity to interact with the students out there of Banarsi Das Chandiwala. And you guys have organized such a nice e-platform in such a pandemic era. So today's topic of discussion is high tibial osteotomy. I am starting my screen sharing. Please wait for a moment. So today I am going to brief you about high tibial osteotomy, which is very less practicing nowadays in hospitals because there are so many recent advances in surgeries in orthopedic like total knee replacement and arthroscopic detective arthroscopies, from where we detect what kind of arthritis patient is suffering from. So what is high tibial osteotomy? Osteotomy of the proximal tibia has been used for more than a century to correct angular deformity in the setting of rickets, poliomyelitis, and post-traumatic conditions. And Jackson is the first English language literature to report performing a proximal tibial osteotomy to treat osteoarthritis of the knee. So osteoarthritis, depending upon the stages of arthritis, we may lead to the surgeries. So stage 2 and stage 3 are the arthritis in which a lot of osteophytes and narrowing of the joint space has been decreased, and these are the things what we have to see before adopting to the surgery. So high tibial osteotomy is not for all the compartmental surgeries. It is only for unicompartmental syndromes, for whether you can say varus deformities or valgus deformities. Jackson's concept was then adopted by Coventry and Insall, who defined and popularized the lateral closing wedge high tibial osteotomy. Lateral closing wedge high tibial osteotomy is the most common osteotomy nowadays surgeon perform. So in the US, initial experience indicated that HTO was effective in relieving the pain of unicompartmental osteoarthritis that I already told you. If you, there is a bicompartmental or tricompartmental osteoarthritis, high tibial osteotomy is not the right surgery for those arthritis, because the name only suggests tibial osteotomy. If both the components are involved, then it may lead to total knee replacement or unicondylar knee arthroplasty. So HTO has been temporized by two factors: recognition of the procedure's limitations, evolution, and clinical success of TKRs. So what are the drawbacks of this surgery? It is not an ideal treatment option for patients with the bicompartmental or tricompartmental disease. Results of the procedure progressively deteriorate because high tibial osteotomy may take only 10-15 years. This surgery is basically to defer the knee replacement surgeries, like in young patients who were suffering from arthritis in 35 or 40 years of age. If they go for a total knee replacement surgery, then the life of knee replacement, total knee arthroplasty, is around 15 to 20 years, whether you can take for a golden implant or sigma implant, whatever implant you can take. The life of knee replacement surgeries is around 15 to 20 years, or it may goes down also if implant loosening takes place, or else infection will take place, or trauma, whatever the reason is. So So to defer those knee replacement surgeries in young age, like if a patient came to us with a 35 or 40 years of age, and he or she may go through a knee replacement surgery. So if he's operating in 40 years of age, then in 60s or in 65 years of age, he again may go through revision knee replacement. So if high tibial osteotomy is the surgery for in 40 years of age, then in 55 year of age, it may go to knee replacement surgery. So what are the uses of high tibial osteotomy? Medial compartment osteoarthritis in physiologically young active patients for whom knee replacement is imperfect for long-term solution. High tibial osteotomy imposes no permanent activity restriction, because in this surgery, they only touches the tibia, not on the whole joint. In knee replacement surgery, the active flexion range is around what we achieve, the good knee range, what we achieve as a physio is only around 115 to 120 degrees. And in high tibial osteotomy, you may achieve the full range. So there is no activity restriction. You may say, the patient may sit on the low surface area also less than 18 inches, or cross leg sitting is also allowed in the same. Superior results are more likely with contemporary fixation and post-operative management techniques after HTO. Evolving controlled resurfacing techniques are contraindicated in the presence of tibiofemoral malalignment. I will explain controlled resurfacing technique later on. So combining high tibial osteotomy with controlled resurfacing procedure may provide better results than HTO alone. So what are the indications for HTO? Osteoarthritis with varus limb alignment or with valgus limb alignment. Adult osteochondritis in which there is inflammation of cartilage. Osteonecrosis, less blood supply to the bone tissues. Posterolateral instability in which tibial plateau may go laterally, leaving the femoral alignment and go into the joint laxity. Ability of the patient to use crutches after the operation and the possession of sufficient muscle strength, obviously. Good vascular status. Varus limb alignment. And the most common indication for HTO is medial compartment degenerative joint disease with associated varus tibiofemoral malalignment. Rationale behind performing a valgus producing HTO in context of unicompartmental degenerative joint disease is to unload the arthritic medial compartment. The ideal patient for this procedure is young and active, obviously. Elderly patients with low functional demand, less than demand, typically are more appropriate candidates for knee arthroplasty. Valgus limb alignment. Isolated lateral compartment osteoarthritis is much less common than isolated medial compartment osteoarthritis. Most authorities have preference for performing a varus-producing distal femoral osteotomy rather than varus-producing HTO. Correcting the valgus angulation on the tibial side of the knee has been criticized because valgus-producing HTO produces obliquity of the tibiofemoral joint line. Adult osteochondritis. HTO should be considered in physiologically young active adults with osteochondritis of the medial femoral condyle. Author reported that HTO reliably decreases pain and improves function in patients with osteochondritis. Osteonecrosis typically affects the individuals older than 60 years, and after 60 years, a total knee arthroplasty and unicompartmental knee arthroplasty is the only option left, because that may involve femoral component also along with the patellofemoral arthritis. HTO is a valid alternative to arthroplasty for physiologically young patients with osteonecrosis of the medial femoral condyle. According to the author, HTO not only decreases discomfort and postpones the need of knee replacement also, but it also leads to regression of underlying disease that I already told you that in 40s or 50s, one patient, if he or she is going for HTO, then it may defer the knee replacement, and the knee replacement will lead into 60s or 70s. So Koshino also observed the efficacy of HTO was enhanced by concomitant drilling or bone grafting of the osteonecrotic lesion. This is controlled resurfacing technique, like while doing high tibial osteotomy, a surgeon micro fractures or that may produce fibrocartilage or hyaline cartilage. So there are certain techniques, regrow technique and osteochondral autograft transfer system. In OATS technique, what they do is they pick cartilage from the unaffected area and put it into the affected area, and they suggest patient not to bear weight on the after high tibial osteotomy. They do not have to put weight on the surgical limb, and within a time period of 5-6 weeks, fibrocartilage and hyaline cartilage may grow, and the pain intensity has gone down, and then after that, activities of daily living of the patient may increased. So posterolateral instability, isolated soft tissue reconstruction procedures for posterolateral insufficiency are likely to fail in the setting of varus alignment because the reconstruction is subjected to excessive tension. Hence, performing a valgus producing high tibial osteotomy before or in conjunction with the ligamentous reconstruction should be considered when there is varus malalignment. So again, chondral resurfacing technique. This technique is for repairing focal chondral defects, including marrow stimulation, subchondral drilling, abrasion, arthroplasty, microfractures, autologous chondrocyte implantation, osteochondral autograft transplantation, and autogenous periosteal grafting. Because most isolated articular cartilage lesions within the knee affect the medial femoral condyle, the realignment procedure typically indicate during knee cartilage repair is a valgus producing high tibial osteotomy. What are the contraindications of the surgery? Severe lateral compartment degenerative joint disease, loss of significant portion of the lateral meniscus, symptomatic patellofemoral degenerative joint disease. Wherever patellofemoral degenerative joint disease came, then total knee replacement is the only option left for patients. And non-cordant pain, patient unwillingness to accept the anticipated cosmetic appearance of the desired amount of angular correction, subluxation of more than 1 centimeter. So comparing arthroplasty versus HTO, isolated medial compartment disease in a physiologically young, high demand individual is the ideal scenario for HTO. Multi-compartmental disease, obviously, it may go to knee arthroplasty only. Isolated medial compartment disease in a physiologically old, low demand individual is an appropriate situation for either total knee arthroplasty or unicondylar knee arthroplasty. Unicondylar knee arthroplasty should not be considered as a substitute for HTO because in unicondylar knee arthroplasty is like practicing from last 4-5 years in India, because it was it involves both the femoral component and tibial components. So we may not compare HTO with the UK. So there are three type of osteotomy techniques: lateral closing wedge, medial opening wedge, and dome osteotomy. Lateral closing wedge osteotomy is the most common what we are practicing nowadays. Dome osteotomy is the least practicing, because in lateral and medial opening wedge osteotomies, the osteotome what they form is in an oblique shape, and dome osteotomy, the osteotome what they form is circular or of another shape according to the deformity happened. So this is the first one, is for a lateral closing wedge osteotomy. So this is the osteotome what they formed. This is a pre-op. This is osteotome what they formed in a varus deformity, and this is after angular deformity being corrected. This is lateral closing wedge. What they do in this surgery is they opened the skin, then fascia, and then put an osteotomy done in the tibia. And if angular deformity is less than 7-8 degrees, there is no need of any graft to be put into the place. But if deformity is more than 8-7-8 degrees, Then silicon grafts are available in the market, or they may take grafts from iliac crest also. And this one is for medial opening wedge osteotomy. This is less common osteotomy performed, because the complications after medial opening wedge osteotomy are like non-union or limb length discrepancy may takes place in after doing medial opening wedge osteotomy. And third one is dome osteotomy, which is very less practicing in India. So this is again close wedge osteotomy, and this is the external fixator what they fixed. So weight bearing after a high tibial osteotomy depends on the implant what they are using. If they are using K wires or plates, weight bearing is not to be allowed for next 5-6 weeks. But if they are putting external fixators instead of putting those plates or K wires, then weight bearing has to be started from the very next day after surgery, because early mobility is the much needed thing nowadays for the patient. How they measure the angular deformity in before doing the surgery? They took scanograms, like one is simple X-ray and one is scanogram what they took. So in scanogram, they find out how much deformity they have to correct. What they do is they took center line from the hip, then on the knee, and then on the ankle. You see, this is the pre-op X-ray and this is the post-op X-ray. So there is a narrowing of the joint space. If you are able to see, there is a narrowing of the joint space here. And after putting fixator on, joint space has been increased. And the deformity has also been corrected. Not completely, but yes, it is. So lateral closing wedge osteotomy is used by Coventry et al. And Insall et al. Advantage of producing a position of two broad metaphyseal surfaces, thus optimizing an inherent stability and healing potential. It is made near the deformity. It permits exploration of the knee through the same incision. Traditionally performed with free hand and cuts and stabilized with either bone staples or cylindrical casts. In ancient times, what they do in a high tibial osteotomy is they just put osteotome and fixed it into the cylindrical cast or plaster of Paris. But the disadvantage of that kind of high tibial osteotomy was late weight bearing, like after 3-4 months. Because after putting having osteotomy done and without putting any graft inside that osteome, the calcification may takes another 8-10 weeks, or it may depends on the patient to patient. Potential problems associated with these methods include patella bulge and inability to precisely achieve the desired amount of correction. More recently, calibrated cutting guides, rigid internal fixation devices, and early mobilization have produced improved results and low complication rates after lateral closing wedge osteotomy, which is very common. So this is the patient with external fixator, pre-op varus deformity, and post-op. See, mechanical axis and anatomical axis both being corrected in a good way. So this is an alignment zig, which allows the surgeon precise control of angular correction and having an adequacy after surgery being done. Medial opening wedge, it is used to treat medial compartment osteoarthritis. Fixation is achieved by either a medial distraction plate or an external fixator. It is technically easier for the surgeon to achieve the precise desired amount of angular correction than with lateral closing wedge. So merits and demerits of the surgery include less extensive surgical dissection if you compare it with total knee arthroplasty. No need to mobilize the proximal fibula. Medial closing wedge constructs are relatively unstable, hence loss of fixation, non-union, and delayed union are likely to be more frequent than after lateral closing wedge osteotomy. Immediate weight bearing is not appropriate after medial opening wedge and typically is delayed for next 6 to 8 weeks. Or depending from patient to patient or depending on the orthopedic surgeon's approach. When medial opening wedge osteotomy fixation is achieved, with a distraction plate autograft or allograft bone is required and associated graft morbidity issues. If external fixation is used, the potential for pin tact morbidity arises, jeopardize frequent salvage with total knee arthroplasty. So dome osteotomy is less commonly used, that I already told you. So to be more technically demanding operation, because of the challenges of creating a curved osteotomy and avoiding atrogenic trauma to the patellar tendon, advantage of intraoperative flexibility, which allows the surgeon to achieve the precise amount of desired angular correction. If combined with external fixation, the amount of angular correction may be adjusted postoperatively as well. In contraindication to lateral closing wedge and medial opening wedge techniques, dome osteotomy permits concomitant anterior translation of the tibial tubercle, which may alleviate associated patellofemoral disease and that may reduce the time of surgery's approach and having advantages of surgery also. So being an orthopedic therapist, I would suggest you to always go for OT sheets, so surgical procedure, how it has to be done, and then after that only you may have to you have to see x-rays being done, so that the range is what you wanted to achieve, then only you're gonna get it. So what are the complications of HTO? Patella baja fracture. Fracture, obviously, while doing surgery, in knee replacement surgeries also, there are periprosthetic fractures being happening. Dr. Shaheen very well know, she was our in our orthopedic team, and she very well know that while doing knee replacement surgeries also, periprosthetic fractures may happen. Non-union, peroneal nerve palsy, compartmental syndromes, infection, thromboembolism. So total knee arthroplasty after high tibial osteotomy following is considered to be more technically demanding than total knee arthroplasty in the absence of prior HTO. In some clinical studies, the results of knee arthroplasty have been inferior following high tibial osteotomy contracture of the patellar tendon, with resultant patella baja increases the technical difficulty of knee arthroplasty after high tibial osteotomy. L-shaped scars from previous lateral closing wedge osteotomy, because in total knee arthroplasty, what they do is they put a midline incision. And in this surgery, high tibial osteotomy, they put a scar on the medial or lateral side, depending upon varus or valgus deformities, without touching a tibial tubercle and a tibial tuberosity. They put L-shaped scars, which from previous lateral closing wedge HTOs pose challenges for the surgeon performing a subsequent total knee arthroplasty because of the potential for skin necrosis. The surgeon must aware of the proximal tibial deformation caused by HTO when planning and executing proximal tibial resection at the time of knee arthroplasty. So here we are going to have our rehabilitation protocol for HTO. So what are our targets? It also has to be divided into short-term goals and long-term goals. One and the most important goal what we have to achieve is early mobilization, because most of the patients after any surgery, not only HTO, the first and the foremost question what patient ask is, how I'm gonna walk, how may I go to washroom, how do I turn into the bed, how do I sit? So these are the only things what we have to educate the patient and what we have to make them do within their pain-free ranges. So what are the targets upon discharge from the hospital? Protected weight bearing. It it again depends on what kind of osteotomy and what kind of implant they put while doing surgery. If they put external fixator, weight bearing has to be started from the very next day after surgery, or depending upon the pain tolerance of the patient. And if any K wire or plates are there, then non-weight bearing ambulation has to be done for next 6 to 8 weeks, or it again depends upon orthopedic surgeon's approach. So without talking to orthopedic surgeon, no weight bearing at all. Ambulating with crutches, rehab brace has to be there for next 5-6 weeks. Sleeping within the rehab brace, home exercises programs like quadriceps strengthening, hamstring strengthening, glutes strengthening, for abdominals, for VMOs. So within gentle and pain-free ROMs has to be done. Goal at 6 weeks post-op, we can remove a brace after that. Then we may progress on up to full weight bearing over 3 to 6 weeks. Ideally would like no joint effusion and full or near full ROM. If joint effusion is there, you may give elevation to the leg, or you may put ice packs. Begin structured physiotherapy using Stairmaster static, and they may use static bicycle also. And goal at 3 months post-op, full range of motion exercises, full weight bearing, without crutches, without any assistive devices. Able to engage in Stairmaster bicycling or hydrotherapy if available. This is accordingly with the first 0 to 3 weeks. So icing to stay away from the inflammation, pain, redness and swelling both. Brace to should be worn all the times unless otherwise instructed. Swelling when sitting or lying down, keep your leg elevated. Make your knee frequently by bending or straightening your knee. This will prevent knee from becoming stiff. Ambulation from the very next day after surgery. But we have to take care of weight bearing. Exercises again, quadriceps, hamstring, abdominals, knee bending, dynamic quads, VMOs, abdominals. And on the fourth week, we may start from a pain-free flexion extension, hip flexion extension in standing, abductors, adductors strengthening, isotonic exercises, isometric hamstring, we are following from the very first day after surgery. And then our main goal is to reach onto the ambulation without any assistive device. So the simple thing is, we have to ambulate the patient in first 5-6 weeks with the walker or crutches, and then after 5-6 weeks, depending upon the condition of the surgery being done, then we may lead to walking without any assistive device also. So in week 6, range of motion exercises again, isotonic quadriceps strengthening, hamstring strengthening, gait training. Gait training depending upon, I would suggest patients who are walking with the non-weight bearing status, I would suggest them to walk with the walker rather than walking with the crutches, because supporting base of the walker is much more higher than crutches. But there are so many surgeons who want patients to be partially dependent with the crutches. I don't know why they suggest crutches rather than suggesting a walker, but I would suggest my patients to walk with the walker only. And they may use static bicycle or mini squats, half lunges, calf raises. So these are the things what we have to keep it in our mind, that before touching any patient, we may have to go through the x-rays, because there are so many things what came up, like if a patient has gone through any lower limb surgery and they may come to our department with a crucial pain. So these are the things what we have to keep it in our mind with the regular approaches.
So I don't think there are questions.
Okay.
Yes, sir. I remember the surgical notes, everything. So
yeah.
The way you said, it's very important not just to learn by the book, but to understand that surgical notes and having a word with the consultant, because for the same type of surgery, different consultant have different views. So
consultant
you have
to consultant. Put your right, view. Right.
It's very important. So there's one question. That was an amazing session, sir. Thank you so much for managing time for us during this pandemic and teaching our students with such simplicity and depth. The clarity of the demonstration was remarkable. Thank you for sharing your valuable and practical knowledge with us, sir. Thank you so much once again. I would also
like
to thank the technical team members, my colleagues, and all the student participants here. Thank you for making it a successful webinar.
Thank you, Shaheen. Thank you, Shaheen.
Thank you so much, sir. Thank you so much, everyone, for being so patient listener.
Thank you, Dr. Priyanka.